everybody. Welcome to the SoxProspects.com podcast. We are the web's number one source for information on the Boston Red Sox farm system from top to bottom, from Fort Myers to Pawtucket and all stops in between. Thank you for listening. My name is Chris Hatfield. I am the executive editor of Sox Prospects, and I'm joined, as always, by our director of scouting, Ian Kundle. Ian, feels like we just did this, brother. We had a month off, and now we've had, like, days off.
Yeah, because we're here for the people, and there's a lot to talk about this offseason, and we recorded a really long one last time and didn't even hit an entire subject. So
Well, we knew going in. We're better at realizing going in that we should take topics off the table.
Well, this one wasn't as time sensitive because it's something that is forward to the future more.
No, we've got a couple.
We're not talking about the Mookie Betts trade. We're talking about something else. Potential. That's right.
Yeah. No, we thought about talking about this last time, but realized we had enough to talk about those timely. So while we have a couple of news items tonight, JD Martinez opted in, or I guess didn't opt out would be the proper terminology. The other thing is the Premier 12 tournament is going on right now. The U.S.'s third game is happening as we speak right now on this Monday night. November the 4th. But we also want to talk about the negotiations of the professional baseball agreement. That's the agreement between Major League Baseball and Minor League Baseball that sets up the minor leagues as we know them and love them, and a somewhat radical realignment that has been suggested by Major League Baseball as part of those negotiations that was reported on a couple weeks ago. I think it's fascinating. I think it's wild. I've got a lot of thoughts. Hopefully Ian does too. Otherwise, it's going to be a pretty uninteresting podcast. But we wanted to be able to get down into the meat on that without having to worry too much about time. So we're going to make that its own episode. So we hope you all are interested in hearing about that. We're definitely looking forward to talking about it. As always, we want to give a shout-out to our $5 level Patreon supporters. That'd be Sox Signatures, Kyle Costigan, Tyler Woodrall, Jeff Traynor, David Nardone, Tim Harding, Bill Stanton, Deb Kendall, Evan Kirkwood, Hurricanes 1, Chris Fox, James O'Hara, Nathan Kenyon, Andrew Wallen, David B., Ben Burnett, Al Mendel, and Kevin Catrides. Thank you, everybody. And, of course, send your emails to podcast@soxprospects.com. We want to talk about what you want to hear about. And, Ian, I actually missed an email last time around because the listener sent it to my email, not the podcast email. So I did find that. And we're going to hit that really quick tonight. So yeah, I mean, that's, again, it's podcast@soxprospects.com. You can email me, but there's a chance I'm going to miss it because I've got a label that populates automatically with emails that go to that email inbox. So to the podcast inbox, sorry. So make sure you're sending stuff there. Ian, let's hit on the news real quick. Let's start with JD Martinez, I guess. Earlier today, it was reported, and I don't know if it's official yet, but JD Martinez has decided not to opt out this year, and he is going to be coming back next year, or at least has...
Well, he's going to be playing...
He's going to be playing on his current contract. He's not going to be a free agent, which I think is important. And I think it got oversimplified, Ian. Tell me if you agree with this, to if JD Martinez opts out, they can keep Mookie Betts. If he doesn't opt out, they are trading Mookie Betts.
Yeah, I don't think that's the case at all.
And it's not. But I'm saying that seems like what a lot of people oversimplified it to.
I agree.
And that's just not the case. I mean, for one thing, I didn't think there was a chance he was going to opt out.
No. The way that baseball is going, I mean, we talk about it all the time. Like, guys who don't play a position who can hit, like, unfortunately, in the current state of game with the DH in only one league and, you know, certain teams not really trying, like, there's just not a huge market. No. Like, there's only a couple DH spots open on contenders, and JD's made it pretty clear he wants to play for a contender.
Yep.
So he's not going to go DH for, like, the Tigers again. Like, well, sorry.
And
they're not going to spend money on him. So it's like his market is so limited that I didn't think he was going to opt out, frankly. And especially because he has leverage. He can opt out again after next season. So...
Next two seasons.
Oh, is it the next two seasons? Okay. I knew he could opt out after next season.
That's the thing is, so let me pull up. I'm on COTS right now.
I mean, the moral of the story is Scott Boras is a genius with the way he designs contracts, but continue.
Well, part of it was, remember what it, the reason the contract, let's back up to this. So he signed a 5-year, $110 million deal before the 2018 season. And the salaries, he gets $23.75 million for the first 3 years of the deal. And in the last 2 years of the deal, he gets $19.375 million. Okay. He has opt-outs after 2019 and 2020. If he had opted out at this year, he would have gotten a $2.5 million buyout. If he opts out next year, he gets no buyout. Okay, I actually had this wrong. So those are the two buyouts. The 2011 and 2022 seasons become mutual options if Martinez has a Lisfranc injury or a complication to his right foot that causes him to be on the DL, or I guess in IL now, for 60 days or more in the previous season, or for 10 days or more in the previous season, and 120 days or more in the two previous seasons combined, which it hasn't happened yet, or if he's on the injured list at the end of the previous season and found that he won't be able to play at the start of the next season. So that would mean, you know, the team can move on from him. No, you know, they can basically void the contract. So the reason for this structure was that they were first worried about the foot injury, so they reworked the deal, and as part of reworking the deal, he got opt-outs in order to keep everything the same. He also has limited no trade to three teams, which, whatever, who cares? It's three teams.
I would disagree a little on the who cares, it's three teams, because for the exact reasons that we were saying, yeah, he wasn't going to opt out, his trade market is also going to be pretty limited in terms of where he could actually go. Because you have to assume no National League team's going to want him because they're not going to want it. He's not a good defender anymore.
Yep.
And so you're limited to American League contenders, and there's probably, what, like six of them, and yeah, how many of them have DHs filled? So I'm assuming Boras is good. I'm sure he's going to block the teams that most fit that need so they can extract something if a trade does go down. So
right,
I think
right,
it kind of does matter that he does have the no trade.
I mean, if you're JD Martinez, who do you set your no trade up for?
Chicago White Sox.
Okay.
I
mean, because part of me would say Yankees, but then it's like the Red Sox aren't going to trade with the Yankees.
No.
So.
I mean, you have to think of teams Angels? That want to contend next year Angels? That have money. Yeah, Angels. And don't have a DH. And then, like.
They've got Ohtani.
So maybe is he DHing? Angels. No. Like, I think the White Sox is the clear number one.
Okay.
Like, maybe Cleveland, but Cleveland can't really afford him. Maybe Cleveland? I don't know. It's going to be teams like that.
Well, and it's funny, too, because someone on the forum was talking about the other day that there's – the way he worded it, and I kind of pushed back against this. There's no precedent for paying a DH more than $20 million a year, and that's true. That's because like 60 players in baseball history have been paid more than $20 million average annual value.
Right.
Contract.
And I bet if you look at David Ortiz's contract, well, if you put it in today's terms, was it $20
million? I don't know about that. I mean, in like accounting for inflation and stuff.
Yeah.
No, I don't know about that. But here's what I looked into is there's 60 players who've been paid, and this is using COTS baseball contracts, which if you're not familiar, get yourself familiar. It's so much better than Sportrack. There are 60 players who have received a $20 million average annual value in a contract. 72 contracts, 12 players have gotten two of them. 24 of them are pitchers. So take out those 24, you're down to 36. One DH. Okay, that's a little lower than you'd expect, but consider that only half of baseball plays with a DH. And there's two other guys who I would have expected to get $20 million. Ortiz, who you mentioned. And Nelson Cruz.
Nelson Cruz just signed a 1-year $10 million or 2-year $20 million contract last year?
Yeah. It was more than that. It was
$220.
Like, I don't think it's that low. I think it's more than that. But here's the thing is that both of them were incredibly late bloomers.
Yeah.
Nelson Cruz, I think it's 6 of his 8 best seasons have come after the age of 31.
Yeah,
Cruz after the age of 33.
Cruz was 226.
Yeah, I knew it was more than 20.
Yeah.
But if you look at him, like, the reason he's never been paid is every contract he's gotten, he's been 30.
Yeah.
Like, no one's going to pay him $20 million at the age of 36.
Yeah.
Like, you'd be crazy. Mm-hmm. But he just keeps hitting for, you know, whatever reason. But he keeps hitting. Same thing with Ortiz. He was such a late bloomer. Basically, the Red Sox signed him to that 1 4-year, $52 million deal. So he came in 2003. They signed him to a two-year extension in 2004 before he became, like, big freaking poppy, right? And then when he was about to hit free agency, they extended him for $452, which was a steal. And then after that, he was old and an injury risk, so he never got paid. Remember how angry he always was with his contract? He hated his contract. So, yeah, those are three guys who would have, but again, two of them were so old. It's just, there's no precedent for JD Martinez being a young, productive DH.
Mm-hmm. And because usually if you're that age too, you're not a DH.
Exactly.
Like, you're athletic enough that you can play the field.
Exactly. So he's kind of a unicorn in a different way but similar in the fact that he was a unicorn to Nelson Cruz and to David Ortiz.
Mm-hmm.
That's really it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the thing is, I didn't see why he would opt out. I mean, he's getting $2.5 million anyway. So that brings the amount of money that he was opting into, so to speak, to $21.25 million. Whereas next year, he makes $19.375 million. His calculus changes a ton next year.
Next year, it makes more sense. Because this year, he's making, like, as you said, almost $24 million a year.
Yeah, 23.75. Now, next year, it drops to 19.375.
Right, exactly. Whereas I think a team would be much more likely, if he opts out next year, to be like, we'll give you, like, a two-year $45 million contract.
Sure.
You know, so he's getting a higher AAV, same length.
Yeah.
Like, that's more realistic to me than him being able to accrue get someone to give him 3 years at like $24 million or whatever.
And that brings me to Mookie Betts, which we're not going to get into the full thing right now. But for everyone saying, okay, this means they're going to trade Mookie Betts. You trade Mookie Betts, you could still lose JD Martinez next offseason.
Right.
Like, you can't, it's not, okay, Martinez is here, so he's here. Like you said, I'm looking into trading both of them.
Yeah, I agree.
Not saying I want to, but you explore the market for both of them.
Correct.
You know, like, on Martinez, you're going to have to eat some money, but, like,
yeah,
you might get a lot for JD Martinez subsidized at, you know, $15 million.
Yeah, and I think the only way they would trade JD Martinez was knowing that they were extending Betts, if that makes sense.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, it's the same, like, reason that you don't want to trade Betts to get stuck holding the bag if Martinez leaves. You don't want to trade Martinez if Betts is still hitting free agency.
But you trade Betts is not like Martinez depends on Betts. Betts doesn't depend on Martinez, if that makes sense. Like, you can still trade Betts, like, now that Martinez is, like, basically for the Betts calculus to me, it comes down to, you go to him, if he's going to extend, if he says he has no interest, then you have to look into it. And if he considers it, you know, you go with your best faith offer, see what he says, and then you go from there. But yeah. So anyway, but that's a whole nother discussion point.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. That's what that is. It's interesting. We'll get into more Mookie Betts talk later. Like Ian had suggested before we started I think it was before we started recording, that we will probably talk a little bit more about that around the GM meetings, because they'll probably start getting some rumors leaked.
Yeah.
That's when it'll probably make a little more sense to talk Betts trade.
I agree.
Or trades generally, because I think
they're going to be a busy offseason. The Rays love trading. Like,
oh, but, well, that, I mean, it's just they have, if they really do want to cut payroll, you have to start making trades.
Yeah.
Of someone.
Like, well, they're going to non-tender people too. Like, Sandy Leon's going to get non-tendered.
Oh, sure,
like,
there's but a that's few not more, moving but, like, the needle much, right?
Like, you're going to have to trade Jackie Bradley. Like, you're going to, there's a bunch of trades that are going to have to happen. But yeah, I think that's a whole nother discussion.
Yep.
We got to talk about some Team USA stuff.
Yeah,
now.
Team USA, man. Have you been following along while we've been doing the opening?
I have.
Okay. What's the score? It looks like it's 8-2. That's good.
Yeah, and Dahlbeck just had an RBI single.
Did he really?
Yeah, and right, Dahlbeck. Well, yeah, or do you want to talk about it? Yeah, you go for it.
Yeah, so the Premier 12, which is a, how often do they play it, Ian?
This one's special though, because it's qualifying for the Olympics, which hasn't been, obviously,
it's every 4 years.
Right. And
the last one was in 2015. Did it replace the WBC? Did they get rid of the WBC? No, I don't think so. It's just a different international tournament played between the top 12 teams.
Yeah.
The last time they played it in 2015, the U.S. was the runner-up to Korea, interestingly. This year, the tournament's being held in Japan, Korea, Mexico, and Taipei. If you are a Red Sox fan, and if you are a Red Sox minor league fan especially, you are particularly interested in Team USA this year because
I said the Red Sox have a lot of stuff there.
Yeah, the Red Sox have four players on Team USA this year. They have Bobby Dalbec, CJ Chatham, Tanner Houck, and Noah Song. Houck is there as a starter. He started game two. Noah Song is pitching out of the bullpen. Dalbec has been starting and hitting cleanup. Chatham, I started the first two games. He's sitting in game three tonight.
He's been batting ninth, but in playing second base too, which I think is noteworthy. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting because I think Dalbec played first base the two games.
He's DHing tonight.
I think he played first base the first two. I know he played first base in one of them.
He was first base
in two of them. Yeah, the first two, and he's playing DH tonight, even though Alec Baum is playing third base, and he is not a third baseman based on what we have heard.
Yeah.
But he probably also hasn't gotten work at first, whereas Dalbec has.
Yeah.
So that makes sense. Team USA split its first two games. They are up 8-2 in the fourth right now against the Dominican team. To be clear, this is not – there are no major leaguer. There's no one on a 40-man roster in the tournament. So you can't be on a major league 40-man roster, which is interesting because this means that Chatham and Dalbec and Houck are all not going to be on the Team USA team if they use the same rules and
– In the Olympics.
The team makes the Olympics, yeah.
Yeah.
Because they're all getting added to the 40-man either this offseason in Dalbec and Chatham's case or during the season, which will almost certainly be the case for Houck.
Yeah.
I can't imagine he lasts more than to like
Well, July. Aren't the Olympics next summer, though?
Are they next summer?
Maybe. Yeah.
But the thing is, they're not going to keep him off the 40-man in order to.
Well, no, I'm saying that maybe they'll let Houck go to the Olympics. I don't know. It'll be interesting to see what happens.
Well, there. I mean, it depends on the rules.
Right, exactly. You know what
I mean, if they use the 40-man rule, they're not going to like hold off
on correct.
Calling him up.
Yeah. But I think of the Red Sox guys, like Dalbec is the one who's getting the most buzz. I know there's been several articles from other outlets talking about him, and Team USA coaches seem to be raving about him and his plate approach. And he's also hit a couple bombs.
Is he getting the most buzz of the four? I don't know that's true. Oh, well, during play, I guess you could say that because he hit home runs in each of the first two games. It's worth noting.
Well, he's an absolute tank, too.
Right. Well, but it's worth noting they're in Guadalajara. And apparently it's like super high elevation.
Yeah, it's a launching pad down there.
It's a launching pad. He's been hitting bombs. So, he's got an RBI single tonight as well. So Dalbec has been hitting very, very well. CJ Chatham, not so much. I mean, he's been okay. 286, 286, 286 across the board. 2-for-7, no walks, no extra base hits. So he gets replaced in the lineup tonight. Dalbec, I believe this is entering the night. Yeah, it's entering the night, hitting 375, 500, 1.125 is the slugging. 3-for-8 with two bombs, 5 RBI entering the night. He has another RBI tonight, obviously. And then on the mound, Noah Song pitched in the first game in relief, had a scoreless inning, did allow a walk, but he... Let's see. Did he get a double play? Yeah, I think he got a double play. So I think he faced the minimum in that one inning. Tanner Houck got the start in game two, went 4 1/3, allowed 3 runs, 2 earned on 5 hits, no walks, 6 Ks. He actually started off really rough in his first inning. Let me get the game up here against Mexico. He gave up 2 runs in the first. Both on a Christian Villanueva single to left center. But then a couple of homers got Team USA back into a tie. And in the fifth, a run scored on a passed ball that I think, that was the unearned run. for Houck. But he, in between the first inning and fifth inning, was mowing guys down. So he recovered.
Yeah, he really settled down.
He settled in really well, which is what you like to see from a maybe starter. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
It is what it is. Yeah, Quiroz's home run was in the previous game again.
Right. Yeah, old friend Esteban Quiroz is hitting for the Mexican team.
Yes. Yes. AKA Jesus Quiroz, if you look on the Mexican league roster.
So, it says Esteban on the thing I'm looking at, but yeah.
No, it's Esteban on the Premier 12, but if you look at the Mexican Pacific League, they still call him Jesus.
Ah, interesting.
It's weird. Anyway, getting into the minutiae.
Nitty gritty, yeah.
But yeah, it's good to see those guys playing for Team USA. It's weird. It feels like in these tournaments, Ian, what usually happens is the Red Sox will have like a Venezuelan guy, maybe a Dominican guy, maybe not. But they scout so well in Venezuela, you would think they would have a Venezuelan guy. You know, sometimes they've got a guy for Taiwan, which they would have if Chi Jung Liu hadn't, quote, gotten hurt. Which I'm skeptical that he actually got hurt, and I'm going to go ahead and assume they just kind of pulled him out of it, honestly. But, so he...
isn't Zhu Weilin on... Oh, no, he's not on the roster.
No, he's not on the Premier 12 roster. He only was playing in the Asian Baseball Championship.
Do you know who is on the Premier 12 roster, though? Chase Xuanlin,
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, as an outfielder again.
Yep.
Yep. Yeah, there's a lot of former Red Sox on other rosters, but no current Red Sox.
Yeah, it seems that way.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting.
I think the guy you were talking about was Song, I'm guessing.
Oh, Song, yeah, because he's gotten a ton of buzz. I guess he threw in a scrimmage before the...
Yeah, and he was up to like 100.
He was up to like 98, 99. I don't think he was up to 100, was he?
But yeah, I mean, I don't know.
Well,
I'm
just saying it generated buzz. I mean, look, if you look at the guys that are on this team... It's guys in the high minors like Joe Adell, Drew Waters, Dahlbeck, Dalton Varsho, and then some of the top draftees from this past year like Alec Baum, Brent Rooker was the year before.
Alec Baum was the year before,
Alec
too.
Baum was the year before,
You're
too.
You're thinking of Andrew Vaughn.
Andrew Vaughn is this year. He was one of the top draftees this year.
You have a couple of younger guys like Xavier Edwards was a couple of years ago.
Xavier Edwards. But the thing is, you know, Song had a little bit of a one of these things doesn't belong here type feel to him, especially if you look at the Red Sox guys there. It's all guys who were in AAA at the end of the year and Song who was in Lowell.
The context makes sense considering what could happen.
But the reason I think he's on there, and it would not surprise me to hear that the Red Sox kind of petitioned to get him on this team.
Yeah.
Because as part of applying for a waiver from military service, they take into account if you are playing an Olympic qualifying team or an Olympic team.
Mm-hmm.
That's given heavy weight. And so this helps his application.
Correct.
And, you know, this actually might be a good time, Ian, to get to the email I missed, which I think I accidentally closed. But, yeah, so... Our email comes, and this is another reason why I felt bad about missing it, but it comes from our frequent emailer, Trevor Latham. And Trevor, first of all, said that he was an international listener from Wawota, Saskatchewan. So we're up in Canada as well. Love to hear it. Thanks for pointing that out, Trevor. But he said, say, what are the odds Noah Song gets to forego his military service commitments, which is a question we've gotten numerous times. But... I accidentally muted it. That's okay. Got it. That's why I closed. But yeah, I mean, thanks for the email, Trevor. But again, it's a question we don't know the answer to. But just to give the update, Song is reporting to Pensacola after this tournament.
Correct, because it's November 18th or something or whatever.
Well, his report date got delayed so he could play in this tournament.
Oh, yeah, it was supposed to be November 1st and it got pushed to December.
Yeah, it got pushed back so he could play in this, which is, again, is another, like, it shows where the thinking is here.
Yeah.
Gun to my head, I think he pitches next year. Is there still a good chance he doesn't? Sure.
I mean, we'll know pretty soon because the waiver, the 90-day window for the Trump administration.
Was it 120? Something. I think it was 120. I thought it was
120. Was it 120?
Yeah.
I think it expires at the end of November, so. Yeah. I believe we will know if that is settled either way by then. And obviously that's going to be pretty much the deciding factor. So depending on what happens with that, we'll know more.
Yeah. I mean, we'll have to see. It's, you know, it's all speculation right now on our end. So yeah, anyway, Julian McWilliams had an article about Song, and his tone has definitely changed a little bit from the company line of "I signed up for military service, I'm going to do my military service," to "Hey, you know, I know what I signed up for with military service, and I'm going to serve proudly." But it seems it's very clear that he wants to play baseball at this point. I mean, the idea of him not wanting to play baseball is, I think we can safely bury that. It's clear he wants to play baseball at this point. So, we'll have to see. We'll have to wait and see. But for now, he pitched well in his debut at Premier 12. Don't know if he's going to pitch tonight. Parker Dunshee, the starter for Team USA, only went 2 1/3. So I could see him pitching in relief tonight for sure. I don't know how many relievers they have, but we'll have to see what happens. So, all right, so that brings us, I guess, into the main event. We'll provide updates on the game tonight for Team USA, especially if Song pitches. But let's move on into this proposed radical realignment of minor league baseball. And I guess I'll start with kind of explaining in a very general sense. We won't get into the exact terms yet. We'll go term by term, Ian, is maybe the way to do this, of our thoughts on it, and then we can kind of wrap up with our overall thoughts. So the professional baseball agreement is up after 2020, and what that agreement is it's the agreement between Major League Baseball and Minor League Baseball that sets up the minor leagues as we know them at this point. If you know your baseball history, you know that this system of affiliated minor leagues is relatively recent. The beginning of a farm system and things like that, you didn't have AAA, AA. I mean, even the classifications are relatively recent. But the professional baseball agreement really hasn't been negotiated or redone in a significant way until since 1990. Ian, does that sound right to you? I'm looking at it right now. Where is it?
It was 1990. It was last fully renegotiated. Between the MLB and the, well, it's governed by the Professional Baseball Agreement, as you said, the PBA. Which, whenever I think of PBA, sorry, I just think it's bowling related.
No. So, right now it goes in 7-year terms, and the 7-year term is up. And MLB wants to fully renegotiate it. And this was reported back around October the 18th. And it's kind of a wild proposal. This would be just, it would completely rework the minor leagues in almost every way. I guess let's start with what is the situation now? Right now, things that are, you need to know to understand the proposal is that teams have no limit on how many affiliates they have. The 4 full season levels, that'd be AAA, AA, Advanced A, or High A, it's the same thing, and regular Class A or low Class A are the 4 full season leagues. Each major league organization has one affiliate at each level in a certain number of leagues. I think there's 2 leagues of AAA, and I think there's 3 at the other 3 levels, Ian. Is that right?
There's 3 AAA, yeah.
There's 2 for AAA.
Sorry, because, 2 for AAA. Yeah,
and there's 3 for the rest. Because the AAA, they used to have one more, American Association.
AA Southern, Eastern, and Texas.
Yep.
And High A's California, Carolina, Florida State, Low A's South Atlantic League.
Midwest.
And
are there only 2?
There's only 2.
There might only be 2. Because the South Atlantic League's got 14 teams. Atlantic League gets broken up in the proposal, which I found interesting. So anyway, And then there's, you know, short season A, which is the level that the little spinners play at. Not every team has a short season A team. There's also a thing called advanced rookie ball, which is rookie ball outside of the complexes, which I think is basically, I don't understand. I've never understood the difference.
It's the Appalachian League. It's the Appy League.
Well, like, and the Pioneer League. There's two of them.
Yeah. But like, but some teams have both like a Pioneer League team or an Appy League team and a Penn League team, like the Rays and the Yankees. Like, it's just confusing.
Yeah. And then there are the complex leagues. Well, the, and the other short season A team is the Northwest League, which you need to know about for the proposal. Moving down, you get to the complexes, which are held at the team's spring training complexes in Arizona and Florida and the Arizona League and Gulf Coast League, respectively. And then from there, there's the Dominican Summer, the Dominican Summer League, where teams have one or two affiliates. Some teams even have two Gulf Coast, like complex league affiliates, like the Yankees have two Gulf Coast League affiliates. The other thing you need to know is that major league clubs pay the players. Minor league clubs do not. The Pawtucket Red Sox do not pay player salaries. They do not pay coach salaries. I don't. Oh no, maybe they might pay the coaches. Hold on, coach. Nope. MLB teams are responsible for paying the salaries and benefits of players and coaches on all affiliated minor league teams, while minor league teams pay for minor league staff, travel, and other expenses. In the case of a short season or rookie level club, players and coaches' salaries would – oh, okay, never mind. Nothing. They don't pay those. Salaries and benefits, this includes workers' compensation insurance. All that is paid by the major league club. The minor league club provides everything else, basically. I think that, is there anything else you need to know about the current state? There's no limit to the number of affiliates you can have other than the fact that they have one each in the full season leagues. I think that's basically it, right?
That minor league players don't make minimum wage.
Yes, thank you.
I think that's relevant too.
That's the other thing I was trying to think of. Thank you. Minor league players get paid very little. We have talked about this on the show. And I don't know if you can pull up the salaries, because that's out there at this point because of the lawsuit, the minor league player wage lawsuit. Minor league players do not get paid during spring training other than per diem. They do not get paid during fall instructs. They do not get paid during things like the Arizona Fall League.
In 2018, excuse me, it was $6,000 in single A, $9,350 in double A, and $1,500 in triple A. And this is assuming you're not on the 40-man roster.
And this is a six-month salary.
Correct. You only get paid in season.
You only get paid in season. But that's like I'm saying the number you just said is full season.
Yes.
Right. So nothing. It's below minimum wage. It's insane. I don't understand why it exists. So I think Major League Baseball understands they need to start paying minor league players more at this point. Like there's no reason for them not to. So there's also this underlying current that has existed for a while that there are minor league facilities that are just completely substandard for professional baseball. If you only live in New England and or have only gone to Boston Red Sox affiliate parks, you are probably unaware of this. Because Red Sox affiliates have pretty much across the board very nice facilities. I would say so, right, Ian? Would you agree with that?
I mean, it's kind of funny to think, but I'd say the worst of the Red Sox affiliates is facilities-wise is their AAA team. But yeah, otherwise, but even Pawtucket is reasonably.
It's not even bad.
Yeah, no,
it's not even bad. I mean, the honestly, though, I would say this. The bad parts about Pawtucket don't have anything to do with the on-field product. They have to do with fan experience.
Yes, I
agree. Because the clubhouse is fine. The facilities are fine. It's just an old park. A fine place to watch a game, but it's like the stands are elevated. It's all concrete. It's just, yeah. I liked going to the park back in, you know, when I was at Brown and right after I graduated when I was still in Providence.
And anyway, it's not going to be an issue because they're moving.
It's not going to be an issue because they're moving anyway and they're going to have a brand new park.
Yeah.
But, for example, one thing that I've learned down here in the Mid-Atlantic, I mean, I go to some dumps, man. I mean, and I'll say this because they're moving. Potomac, where the Potomac Nationals played, dump. And that's why they're moving. That's why they're moving to Fredericksburg. It's not a good park. It feels like you're at a fairgrounds. That's not even the worst park I go to around here by a long shot. It's not, you know, and I don't want to throw any particular organization under the bus, but
it's not just like on the East though. Like in the Midwest, there's some really bad parks. Like it's all over the country.
Yeah.
Like,
I mean, Keith Laws,
there's a reason the Red Sox bought out of the California League, for example.
Oh, well, I mean, and part of that is player development too. I mean, that's the other thing too. You have to understand some of these places are in such bad environments, like Lancaster, where the Red Sox were for 2 years, and we'll talk about this, literally has a jet stream going out to right field. You can't develop baseball players in that.
That was like, I remember this is, we did the Sox prospects like a minor league fantasy league just as like a joke here. Yeah. And I remember like the entire Lancaster team was drafted in the first round because like Bubba Bell was going to hit like 35 home runs here and like Zach Dagas and like, but
Tony
no
Granadillo.
Yeah. But no Lancaster pitchers were drafted because there's no point. If they had an ERA under six, it was like shocking.
The funny part is I think the pitchers probably did better coming out of there because like Masterson came out of there.
Yeah.
And the fact that he like wasn't terrible in Lancaster was like, oh, this is a guy. Okay. Mm-hmm. But he was also a sinker baller, which is perfect for Lancaster pre swing path. Anyway, these are the things you need to know. And I mean, some of these facilities are terrible. Like, I mean, Keith Law name dropped Clinton, Iowa as a team that no major league organization wants to be affiliated with because their park is a dump, basically, in not so many words. But because of the way the PBA is set up, they're always going to have a team to be affiliated with. This proposal just blows the whole thing up, basically. And so the big overlying theme of this is it's called the 120 plan, because what it is there are 160 teams that are in affiliate, 160 minor league teams in affiliated baseball. Okay. That are not at the complexes. So remember what we were just talking about. This takes out the Arizona League, the Gulf Coast League, the Dominican Summer League. Those don't count. Those can stay. Those are fine. Cause there's no,
well, they already have, and they're owned by MLB. Like every one of the,
well, it's not even owned. It's like your guys who are at the facility playing games.
Yeah, right.
Is what it is. It's not really, you know, when people say, oh, does it cost money to get into a Gulf Coast League game? It's like, no, because it's not the same. There's no concessions. There's no, you're just going into a park and watching a game. It might as well be Legion Ball, right? So we're just talking about the teams at advanced rookie ball and above. There are 160 of those teams. This proposal would cut it from 160 to 120. There would actually be 42 teams, not 40, that would be excised from affiliated ball. And what actually happens, it's interesting, and I don't know if you caught this, but there's two indie league teams that would get promoted, essentially, up to being affiliated.
I did see that, because they have such nice facilities.
Nice facilities, and they're known. Good. I mean, the St. Paul Saints and the Sugarland Skeeters are
legit. Well, it's two excellent locations for baseball, too.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep, exactly. So
they probably draw more than some affiliated teams.
I mean, the St. Paul Saints automatically become a Twins affiliate, right?
Yeah, they have to, yeah.
I mean, it makes too much sense.
Yeah.
So, anyway, that's the big overarching theme to all of this, okay? 42 teams get excised, you cut from 160 down to 120. The clubs that are removed, the 42 clubs that are taken out, would either become part of what's called the Dream League or would be encouraged to become wooden bat leagues. Because the thing is with the Dream League is it would be a league for undrafted players. And we'll talk about changes to the draft in a minute because it would change the draft. Mm-hmm. Undrafted players would play in what's called the Dream League. And it's basically, to me, it sounds a lot like the G League for people who follow the NBA, where maybe you don't have the affiliated players. Like there's no Taco Fall.
Well, no, I think it was the G League in its initial conception.
Okay.
Because the G League has evolved to try and become a minor league system. But when it first started, it was just whatever. It was 14 teams with 14 players that NBA teams could call guys up. Or add them to their
sign
roster.
Them.
Yeah, sign them.
Yeah.
But no one was affiliated with anyone.
It was like an indie league.
Correct, yeah. But it was owned by the NBA.
Yes. So the Dream League would be similar, where it's a pseudo indie league. But the problem is the Dream League teams would pay those salaries and the insurance and everything and the benefits to those players, including workers' comp.
Should never work.
Well, it could work. The problem is it's like the example in one of the articles, I think it was the Evandrelic article or maybe it was the Keith Law article. Like Appalachian League teams could never afford to pay that. Some of them are in towns that have fewer than 20,000 people in them. Okay.
Yeah, no, like I've been to minor league games that were like even in the middle of summer, there's no more than like 1,000 people there.
Oh, and we'll talk about attendance. Like, we'll get to that.
Yeah.
So, you know, these Appy League teams would be encouraged to become like collegiate Summerwood bad leagues where you're not paying the players. Right. Okay. So that's what happens to those teams. The teams that are not excised, that stay, there would be radical realignment. Teams switching levels, moving down, moving up. The leagues would basically be carved up into being much more geographically logical.
Yeah, which I think makes – I think that is the biggest, like, most important thing to me that needs to happen. Because, like, especially in, like, AAA – I mean, the higher you get, I think it's more of an issue. But I guess maybe not because you can fly at least
AAA. AAA, they fly. Like, the Reds – the Pawtucket team flies to Charlotte.
For example, like, look at the South Atlantic League. Lakewood is in the South Atlantic League in New Jersey. And Greenville is, too. That's – I don't know how long a drive is. I'm going to guess that's an 18-hour drive.
No, it's – hold on. Because Keith Law has examples of some of the worst bus rides.
Bus rides, yeah.
So, yeah. Okay, so he lists, you know, there are 2.25-hour bus rides, Springfield to Corpus Christi in the Texas League. 12.5-hour bus rides, Grand Junction to Great Falls in the Pioneer League.
Oh, that was Lakewood to Rome, yeah.
And Lakewood to Rome is 12.75 hours.
It's probably
not
18 hours. It's probably like 9 hours, but yeah.
No, 12.75 is Lakewood to Rome.
That's right, so Lakewood to Greenville is probably like 9 hours because Rome is about 3 hours from Greenville.
Yep, okay, got it. Sorry.
But you think about that. That's New Jersey to Georgia.
You're taking a bus overnight, playing a game the next day.
Yeah.
I don't get it. It's, you know what I mean? So that makes a lot of sense. You've got teams that are, I mean, like, thinking of around me, right?
Mm-hmm.
I can drive from here to Bowie, Frederick, Hagerstown, 3 different levels.
Yeah.
Why?
Same with me.
Why?
I can It's nice because
you can see all those levels, but I completely get why Major League Baseball is saying we can have a team play 3 other teams within like an hour and a half drive. Mm-hmm. Why are we not doing that? That's crazy. Yeah. It's the same reason that like the Gulf Coast League, you play a division of like 3 or 4 other teams and that's it.
Yeah.
Because they don't want to send you across the state to go play another rookie league team.
Well, it's like minor league spring training too. You compare it with major league spring training where, you know, they're playing like they go have to win the Red Sox.
It's the same thing with minor league spring training. It's exactly the same. Yeah.
Yeah, but that's what I mean. Like, you think about Major League Spring Training, they send them to, like, Jupiter. It's like, okay, you're not – none of the good players are going to go when the Red Sox go play there. Mm-hmm. But in the Minor League Spring Training, the farthest they're going is, like, Tampa or the Baltimore facility. And so they don't – that's not an issue during spring training for them. So, yeah.
Right. Right. So, yeah. So they're going to completely realign the leagues. The minor league baseball hates everything we've said so far because, first of all – teams that have affiliations don't want to lose the affiliation, right? That's basically destroying the value of their franchise. The value is in the player, the development affiliation, the player development contract, the PDC. Okay, so that just annihilates the value of your team. There's also a plan in this proposal, which I guess wasn't a formal proposal; it's just negotiating that the. Sorry, just letting the cat out of here. The teams would be compensated a given amount based on if you moved down an affiliation, you would lose money. If you moved up, you would have to basically pay in. But the problem is that like the numbers have nothing to do with what teams are actually being sold for. They're just completely random. So they hate that. Why do this? The reason, in theory, and this is, as Keith Law pointed out pretty astutely in his piece about it, you know, is not necessarily tied to this, but MLB is saying the reason is is that they would increase player salaries by at least 50%.
And I think that's something that needs to be discussed too, because in the context of player salaries, because of heavy lobbying by Major League Baseball, they were tacked onto, was it the tax bill last year or something?
Yeah. I mean, it was called the Save America's Pastime Act, but
basically it gave MLB or minor league baseball a tax like exemption status or some exemption that allowed them not to have to pay minimum wage to their players.
Right. Right.
So they're not considered employees or something. So they don't have to be paid a living salary or a living wage.
That's one way to put it.
Yeah.
That's one way to put it. But at any rate, they're saying, look, if we are going to increase payer salaries, we want minor league baseball to take some of the load. And according to Evan Drellick of The Athletic, he wrote an article about the negotiations that went a little deeper into the negotiations. This initially broke in a Baseball America piece. And Drellick added a little bit of color to the negotiations. Apparently, Major League Baseball is saying that they approached the minor league organizations about helping to pay the salaries, and that was a non-starter. And they said, you know, they would rather have fewer teams than do this. This is according to Major League Baseball. But apparently now minor league baseball is saying, heck no, this is not what we want. To me, the key thing, if you look in the Baseball America article, there's a quote from Major League Baseball Deputy Commissioner. Let me find it. Okay, yeah, Deputy Commissioner Dan Halem. And he says, we're at the very initial stages of negotiations where each side is presenting to others the issues and concerns they have with the existing PBA. From the perspective of MLB clubs, our principal goals are upgrading the minor league facilities that we believe have inadequate standards for potential MLB players, improving the working conditions for MLB players, including their compensation, improving transportation and hotel accommodations, providing better geographic affiliations between major league clubs and their affiliates, as well as better geographic lineups of leagues to reduce player travel. I don't believe that is at the forefront of what MLB cares about. The forefront is obviously the bottom line, right? Of course it is. It's the money, stupid. Right.
Well, yeah, because if it was that, I think that's a lot of that sounds really good.
Yeah, a lot of it sounds great. But and this is a thing that Keith Law pointed out, is that the unfair piece of this to minor league clubs, because this is initially presented as MLB being super greedy. And I think that's in part because of the way the Baseball America article was written. I'm going to be honest here. It's written very much as there's this crazy thing that's going to just blow up minor league baseball. And it's written in a very pro minor league baseball perspective to me. That's my editorial comment, mm-hmm. right?
And I don't think it would blow up minor league baseball if it did happen either. That's the thing. Yeah,
you have to be willing to think outside the box. And I'll get to that with kind of my concluding thoughts. But the one unfair piece that Keith Law points out is like the timeline is kind of unfair. You're giving organizations a year to get their acts together and get better facilities. Like that's it, huh? There's no way they can do that, right? A lot of these teams play in, you know, city municipal stadium. It's owned by the city.
Yeah, they're not going to be able to just, and the city's not going to just go out and throw money at it to improve it. So
no. And now, as pointed out by Ben Gelman Chomsky on Twitter. When I mentioned that, is some of these are really nice parks. I think Charlotte or Durham. I think Charlotte pays in at the city owned park. That's beautiful, one of the best in the minor.
Yeah, I've been there. It's gorgeous.
Yeah, but it's so brand I'm not new, saying
like downtown. Yeah,
yeah. I'm not saying that means it's bad, right? But you know, it's just the point is that you can't just automatically fix it if you're playing in a city owned park. Right. And a lot of teams, even if they had their own park, wouldn't necessarily be able to fix it right away. So that's an unfair piece of this. But, you know, looking at some of the other pieces, we talked about the affiliation. Teams don't love the 2-year player development contract system, which I get because it leads to having to play in bad locations in terms of geography and bad locations in terms of the facilities, the player development climate, whatever. And I'll use, for example, your World Series champion Washington Nationals. Ian, where is their AAA affiliate? Do you know?
It's in the Pacific Coast League. Is it? It's not Reno.
Nope.
Reno's Arizona.
I think you're close because it sounds like Reno. Fresno Grizzlies.
Fresno. Yeah, I knew it was somewhere out in the Pacific Coast League. Yeah.
The Nationals, to call a player up, have to fly that player across the country from Fresno. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I guarantee you, when that 2-year PDC is up, they are getting the hell out of there if they can.
Yep.
Red Sox, let's take the Red Sox, had a high A affiliate in Sarasota, Sarasota Red Sox. That was when I started following the team. I think before then it was in Grand Haven. But it was Sarasota when I started following. That's where Hanley Ramirez played mm-hmm. when he was coming up.
Were the Sarasota Green Jackets or something?
No, Augusta Green Jackets were the Sally team.
Oh, okay.
My first minor league cap, in fact, at the 99 All-Star game was an Augusta Green Jackets hat. Money logo. It was like a green hat with a purple bill. Fly as hell. Anyway, Sarasota in the Florida State League. They moved their affiliate for reasons I don't know, but, you know, they moved their affiliate to Wilmington in the Carolina League. Wilmington, Delaware, longtime Royals affiliate, for whatever reason, signs up with the Red Sox for 2 years. At the end of the 2-year PDC, Wilmington says, we don't like the way the Red Sox call their players up, and they go back to Kansas City. Red Sox are left holding the bag. They wind up for 2 years in Lancaster. A, it's in California. At that time, they're in Greenville. So the way you go to get to California is from Greenville. If you get promoted from California, you're flying to Portland. Suboptimal. We saw a number of players skip high A, not for promotions, but like to make a spot start. Because you're not going to send a player from California to Portland to make a spot start. You're going to call him up from Greenville. Just, it's not optimal. Add the fact that Lancaster has this jet stream. They did avoid, if they could, sending pitchers there. Right? They had no idea what to make of hitter stats from there. Because, I mean, Bubba Bell in 2/3 of the season won the California League MVP. Never did anything again, pretty much. He was pretty good in Portland after that, but never hit in Pawtucket. He was one of the best players in the minors that year because of the park he played in. There shouldn't be a team in Lancaster. It's nuts. At the very least, move the park, okay? These are the kinds of things you have to deal with in the current system. So they want to lengthen the PDC. They want it to be longer. I think it would be 5 to 7 years. It gives the team more certainty, but it also killed negotiating leverage for minor league clubs, which I don't get why they need. I don't understand why they need leverage. They're getting free labor. What leverage do you need? You know, I never understood that piece of it. So that's another piece of it. And apparently the affiliates would be more geographically tied to where the clubs are. So no more having your affiliate on the other side of the country. I mean, that's probably why they want the St. Paul Saints to be a minor league team, because they would become a Minnesota farm team. Probably be their AAA team, right? So you would at least probably want to have your AAA team close by.
Right now, their AAA team's Rochester, New York, which is not, kind of far away from New York.
You can't bus them, but it's a short flight.
Yeah.
But anyway, yeah. So geographically closer affiliates. Let's see. The players I'll mention. What's up?
I was just going to say we should mention that in terms of Red Sox affiliates, one has been mentioned.
That's where I'm going to go. Yeah. Okay, so we mentioned cutting teams. The teams getting cut, it would get rid of short season and advanced rookie ball. That would include – that was literally where I was going next. That would include the Lowell spinners. So under this – it's not a formal proposal, but under this idea, the Lowell spinners are gone. No more Lowell spinners, Go ahead. I'll let you go.
Well, no. I was just going to say they could enter the Dream League. It just would depend on what the owner wants to do, it seems.
Yeah. Yeah. Right? I could easily see them being a Dream League team.
Yeah.
It would make sense. You know, New England's a good place for summer baseball.
Correct. I mean, it's at a university already, so.
Right. That's the only place you could, I mean, you can only do summers that you can't, Lowell can't be a full season team. That's no. probably the other thing we should mention. Lowell can't Correct. Be a full season team because it's the stadium is at U Lowell.
Yeah.
And, you can't have players there. I mean, they were screwed up when Lowell made the playoffs because the parking was gone.
Well, and it's also the players stay in the dorms. I don't know if people know that, but at Lowell, the play. So like if in season, just it would complicate things greatly.
I mean, you just wouldn't be able to put them in the dorms anymore.
Yeah. Well, no, but also the UMass Lowell team is playing there. Baseball team plays there. So you'd have to schedule around that.
Yeah. They it would complicate things.
They do Massachusetts high school baseball there. Like it's just because the team doesn't own the stadium either. So it's just, it's complicated.
Right. Right.
But yeah.
So, I mean, you could schedule around road trips, but it would be hard. It would, it would be very complicated. So the Lowell Spinners wouldn't exist. The leagues that do continue to exist would be reorganized to be geographically compact. In the Baseball America article, it mentions the Pacific Coast League would drop from 16 teams to 10. The International League would go up to 20 teams. So the International League would pick up six teams. That's because the International League geographically is closer to the major league clubs, I would assume.
Yeah. Well, because I think with AAA, you kind of, since they're flying, you have a little more leeway. And so, like, if you but just broke it down.
Go ahead. Sorry.
No, I was just going to say, if you kind of break it down and it's the Pacific Coast League is just like the literally the teams on the Pacific Coast and then maybe out to like the Rocky Mountains and then the International League's everything else, you can pretty much get there. Because it also like when you're talking about the Pacific Coast League teams, I would assume like they would pick up Vancouver, for example, because Vancouver right now is like a short season team, but that park's gorgeous and it draws like that could move.
It used to like, be a AAA team.
Oh, really? Okay.
Vancouver. Yeah. They used to be a AAA club and they moved.
But yeah, so like things like that.
Yes, the International League would go up to 20. The South Atlantic League would lose eight teams that would form a new Mid-Atlantic League.
Makes sense.
So the South Atlantic League would be more to the south, and there would be a Mid-Atlantic League that would probably, you know, include the teams in my area.
Well, that's where you would probably – but that's also like – because some teams from the short season would be moving up. So, like, well, I'm thinking, like, Aberdeen would go into that. Like, Brooklyn probably would.
Yeah, Aberdeen would definitely not lose its –
Yeah.
Yeah. And Aberdeen like, would definitely
continue. For Brooklyn, I guess, has a really nice stadium. They would move up. Like teams
Probably
like
Staten
that.
Island.
Would, yeah. They would move into like the Mid-Atlantic League, quote unquote.
Yeah. The Northwest League in particular, which is a short season A team, it's the counterpart to the South, to the New York Penn League. The Northwest League would become a full season league.
Makes sense.
Because those teams draw their good parks. Those leagues would continue to exist. The, for example, like the Appalachian League gone. And actually maybe this is a good point to talk about attendance because I'm not sure people realize this. There were 12 teams this year in minor league baseball. There's 160, like I mentioned, teams that have, you know, their own parks. They're not just at the complex. 12 of those teams did not draw 1,000 fans a game. The Dunedin Blue Jays drew 203 fans per game. 203.
Seems good.
The Florida Fire Frogs drew 327.
Yeah.
The next three teams, I mean, it's all Appy League and South and sorry, and Florida State League.
Florida State League, yeah.
Except for the Hagerstown Suns, which drew 918 fans per game. And again, this is per game. It's more than that on opening day and stuff. I've been to Hagerstown. The series I saw this year, there couldn't have been 200 people in the park.
Yeah.
These are not, you know, people are saying, oh, towns are, you know, towns are going to lose their baseball.
Folks, nobody goes to the games.
No
anyway.
One's going to these games in these towns.
Well, and I think the other thing people talk about is like the loss of jobs or whatever at stadiums.
This these is are a, kids on summer.
Yeah, this is a little dirty little secret, but a lot of parks are staffed by interns.
Yeah.
They don't hire full-time employees or they have interns or really old people doing their work that they either do give them college credit or they pay them a very, very small salary.
Yeah.
It's not like they're taking away many full-time jobs.
Yeah.
Like,
I mean, there's parks in the New York Penn League that are brutal.
Yeah.
You know, there's parks. There's, put it this way, of the 160 teams, there are only 122 teams that drew at least 2,000 people this year.
Yeah. And this is the thing, when they say drew 2,000 per game, that's an average. And as Chris said, like there's certain like promotional nights that they do much better, or like opening night. Like I've been at games where the attendance, quote unquote, which is AKA sold tickets, is over 1,000 and there's like 100 people there.
Yeah. That's the other like, thing too, is that's not in park. That's not,
no, it, that's the attendance is sold tickets. It's sold tickets.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Yeah. Even that's probably it. Cause like I said, at Hagerstown, when I'm there, it's 150 to 200 people. Maybe.
Right. It's yeah. It's sold
one
tickets.
One night I started counting people and then like something interesting happened and then I stopped.
But yeah. So it's like, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, in Hagerstown, the field slopes. I mean, you can see it from the stands. You know what I mean? I mean, that's the kind of thing they're saying with the bad facilities. I've gone to other parks where I went back when I was doing interviews with players and gone into the clubhouse to get a guy or go after the game and get a quote. There were worse than the locker rooms I changed in high school. Like, it's incredible. Like these, some of these facilities, they're just not good.
Yeah.
So, you know, when we say this is what we're talking about, like I said, if you've only gone to games in New England to Red Sox parks, you don't really get this.
Yeah, because like Portland's a really nice park, mm-hmm. good facilities there.
Yeah.
New Hampshire's a very nice park.
Yeah, New Hampshire's great.
Lowell's fine, like park wise. I mean, there's some other
it's
things.
It's fine for short season. Yeah. If, you know.
For short season, it's fine. Pawtucket is, as we discussed
they're
already.
They're moving anyway.
But, and they're moving anyway. Hartford's brand new. Yeah. Like all
Connecticut
the
Defenders, how's that park?
You mean Connecticut Tigers?
Tigers.
That park is not good. That's not a good park. No. Okay. Yeah, I would not be. I think that one's probably gone.
That one's probably axed. I think most of the New York Penn League's probably axed.
Yeah. I mean, the only one that
you keep Aberdeen, you keep Staten Island and Brooklyn.
Keep Brooklyn. Yeah. Because like Vermont's not really a park you want to keep. But yeah.
Well,
but, like,
is it? I don't know. I mean, Burlington's great.
But like in terms of the double A or higher parks in the Northeast, they're very nice. Or even where the Red Sox affiliates, like Greenville's a gorgeous park. That's my favorite park in the stadium.
Oh, yeah.
Or sorry, park in the system. Like,
and you could also easily put a double A team there.
Oh, absolutely. And they draw too.
Yeah.
Greenville draws great. So,
well, they're in a college town.
Yeah. But it's also a really nice park. So yeah.
Let me really quick go through all the rest of the stuff. Like I mentioned, some teams would switch levels. They would call up into affiliated ball the St. Paul Saints and the Sugarland Skeeters. Sugarland Skeeters are in Texas. The draft would move until after the College World Series. It's frankly, it's silly that it's before it right now, cause it just makes things so complicated with signing players. The draft would also be cut to 20 to 25 rounds. Because of the later draft, that would mean that the players probably wouldn't make their in-game debut until the following year. They would basically go to instructs. Like there would be a long instructs. And this is where I kind of disagree with this proposal. This proposal would cap each team at one complex league team. I would say let clubs do more than one. Like, why are you capping the complex leagues? Let organizations do two GCL teams.
Well, some have it already.
Well, that's what I'm saying. You wouldn't be allowed to anymore under this proposal.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But, like, let that make up for it. You would almost wind up with a JV and a varsity
GCL. Well, I think the reasoning is that they're trying to lower
the number of
minor league players.
Right.
No, but I'm saying that by limiting the number of rounds of the draft, and as we know, I mean, we're not going to talk about it really here, but MLB obviously is pushing heavily for an international draft to like they want to. The goal is to limit the amount owners have to outlay on minor league player salaries.
Oh, sure, and you know what?
You do that by cutting the number of teams.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's how the draft would work, and the players who don't get drafted would go into the Dream League, which we mentioned. The Appalachian League and the Pioneer League probably wouldn't be able to handle the costs, so they'd be encouraged to become Summerwood Bat League teams. Like I mentioned, five affiliates, four full season, one at the complex. Dominican Summer League doesn't get touched. Under contract maximum, you could have 150 to 200 minor league players under contract at a given time. I don't love it, but I get it. Because like Ian said, here's what it comes down to. They want fewer players under contract in order to raise salaries. And you know what? I get it. Right now, the draft is too long. Many players drafted, dirty little secret, are drafted to fill the Lowell and GC for the Red Sox, but the short season and rookie league rosters.
Yeah.
That's it. That's the reason these players are drafted.
Well, I think
Lowell needs a catcher.
We've talked about it before on the podcast. Like, no team has 25 prospects on that team.
No.
Like, there's always going to be, like, filler guys.
Well, never mind. I mean, there's filler guys on every roster.
Right.
But to me, in short season especially, and in rookie ball, mm-hmm. let me put it this way. Players drafted after the 25th round, one out of every 100 makes the major leagues, maybe. I think there's a number. You think that's high?
I mean, who knows? But I could. That's basically, you're saying one every 3 rounds?
Yeah, it says, okay, in the Drellick story, it says, this is a quote from MLB's deputy commissioner. The reality is that 95% of players drafted after the 25th round do not make the major leagues, and most are essentially filling roster spots in short season rookie or low A leagues in order to stage games. It's a tough sell to tell major league clubs that they need to hire more players than they may need in order to provide free labor to the minor league clubs. That sounds harsh, but it's true. It's true. Why should major league clubs... Look, if you're saying major league clubs pay players a living wage, why can't they say, okay, we're only going to hire the players that we think can make the major leagues then? Isn't that completely rational? It sucks. You know, I'm sorry that, you know, Tommy the college senior doesn't get to play pro baseball for 3 years before retiring.
But I think the counter to that is, like, it's you can't find, like, 25 guys for each team with major league potential. You know what I mean?
Oh, then you're not going to.
Yeah, that's what I mean. So there's always going to be filler. There's always going to be filler. But, yeah. But if you trim it like this, then, yeah, basically what you're doing is you're going to have to push guys more aggressively.
Well, and I think you recalibrate the leagues.
Yeah, I guess it would have to be recalibrated. But, yeah, because, yeah.
I think low A becomes worse because Eric Van, who posts on our forum sometime, came in and was talking about a study he did when he was working for the Red Sox, saying that, yes, short season is completely necessary. It's a necessary step in development. Okay, that short season as it exists right now because it was way too big of a jump to low A. If everybody is making that jump to low A, then low A comes down to meet the level of play. Plain and simple. Same thing. I think you recalibrate. I think, you know who else you lose a lot of? The major league retreads in AAA. Let's be honest here. It's the guys who kick around AAA for 6 years. If you've only got a certain number of minor league players you can have under contract, you're not necessarily going to have 10 guys for major league depth in AAA.
Well, and it's funny to think, like, it's not just, they're not, some of them aren't even major league depth. Like, I know there's certain players that I've seen for the last, like, 5-6 years on international league rosters. Mm-hmm. Every time I go, this person, and they'll be on a different team every year or every 2 years, and they're going to go there, they're going to hit 240 with 25 home runs and play a adequate third base or first base or whatever. And it's like, oh yeah, this guy will be on, like, you know, Buffalo next year after being on Rochester this year. And like
Mike Hessman.
Yeah.
It's Mike Hessman.
Yeah.
Right. It's, you know, the Red Sox didn't have any of the true journeymen, I don't think, on there.
But like Chris Marrero.
Yeah. Chris Marrero is a good example.
Like
who they had.
Okay. Yeah. I think he was in the Pacific Coast League this year.
And
like,
keep in mind the major league clubs expanding to 26 impacts that too. You can carry one more of your major league depth guys, you know? But I get it. I'm fine with fewer spots. I think it's logical. You're cutting the long shots. I mean, I did the math on our forum of the hitters in the system back when the Red Sox were ranked the number 2 system in the game. They produced 10 major leaguers, 10 or 12 true major league regulars, when they were one of the best systems in Major League Baseball. Think of what the bad systems are producing. 4. And you're paying 280 guys to get 4 guys. I get owners saying no.
Yeah.
Because the thing is, if you cut the draft off at 25, the major leaguers you're losing, and I hate to use a current example because the one that comes to mind is like a Trevor Kelly, who's going to come up and get a cup of coffee. It's a Mike Miller was a senior sign, but it's the late round guys, that make the major leagues and become star, like, quote, late round guys, are like 10th, 11th, 12th, 15th round, 20th round. Mauricio Dubon, I think, was...
He was a high school pick,
23rd.
But yeah. But like the thing is, if they change short in the draft, then they'd have to change the current system because the slot pool thing wouldn't work, and it would recalibrate again, like where people are taken might change.
Well, right, so. And the thing is, with 25 draft slots, you're not going to draft eight guys you know you're not going to sign just in case. You're going to use all 25 spots on players that you want to sign, right? So that's going to change, and I'm fine with that. You know, the communities would lose their baseball. To me, you know, there's clubs that draw under 1,000 per game. What, the community doesn't care about that team. And that's not even drawing. Like you said, that's sold tickets. You know, this is 100% about cutting costs. I get it. It's just that the way they're cutting costs is completely rational to me. Get rid of the facilities that aren't up to par. Wouldn't surprise me to hear that Hagerstown that loses its team under this proposal.
Well, that's the thing. I think it's like a lot of their proposals have merit, but at the same time, their Major League Baseball isn't exactly its best PR friend when it's getting framed by a lot of places as like just cutting costs.
Yeah. I mean, they are.
Right. It's just, but it's also not the greatest look when you have, you know, billionaire owners wanting to skimp like $1 million to save $1 million in player salaries or, you know, $1 million it costs for minor leaguers. You know what I mean?
Sure.
Like, that's not exactly the greatest PR look, but...
And the thing is, the players still aren't going to be making much.
No, not at all.
Adding 50% to 60K, it's 6K becomes 9K. Whoop-dee-doo.
Yeah.
You know, they still have a long way to go.
But I think,
player salaries.
Again, this is just like a basic, like, entry level. Like, it seems like just like some ideas as kind of a drawing board to work from.
And that's the big
thing. And, like... It's obviously going to be heavily negotiated, and if this is the plan they end up going with, and because there's going to be, you know, you got to, like, the minor league owners are going to come in, the ones who are losing their parks are going to be like, well, we bought in under the assumption we'd be with an affiliated team. Like, how do they get compensated? You know what I mean?
They need a better way to compensate.
Like, that's not going to work. Like,
they need a much better way.
The way they described isn't going to work. The higher salaries for players, better facilities, like, that would be great. The shorter travel is going to be good. Like,
and here's,
but it's the timing. The thing is, the thing that gets me is I'm just not sure how they can accomplish as radical a change as this in 2 years, because it has to be renegotiated before 2021. This is like something that is like a 5 to 10 years out plan, not like we have a thing expiring in 2021 or after the 2020 season. So after next season, the PDA is gone. PBA.
Yeah.
And so, like, I don't know how you can implement something as, like, wide-ranging and sweeping as this in that little time.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, Keith Law, to that point, had a suggestion. You know, he says, since most stadium construction projects, whether new or renovation, are funded at least partly by local governments, getting those done inside of a year is not practical. MLB could choose to put any potentially contracted / demoted franchises into tiers. Some leave affiliated baseball immediately, while others, such as those in markets MLB deems more important to growing the game, get another 2 years to bring their facilities up to the new standards. I'd give them longer. And I think that's the part of this that's not tenable, is that it's, you can't do this in that amount of time. I think what would make sense is if they do this next PBA, okay, and they say, this is going to be a 5-year PBA. Teams, you are on notice. You've got X amount of time. I mean, but maybe you can't do that because you don't want to have towns put money into fixing the stadium and then they lose the park anyway. So maybe you do the tiers thing. Maybe you say, hey, these towns, you have to bring your facilities up to this level or you're losing your team. You know, we'll cut a league. It's fine. You know, maybe get rid of advanced rookie, but you keep short season A. I don't know. I guess you would still need 30. So you'd still need 100. You could only cut 10 teams that way. But I don't know. I think that part, and the part about owner compensation, doesn't make sense in this proposal, and I think that could be a major sticking point. I think you're going to have lawsuits.
Maybe that's why they're
saying it now. Get the lawsuits out of the way. Get the injunction lawsuits. Get the TROs out of the way. The temporary restraining orders. Let's get that done with. Let's go through the legal process. Hell, maybe I should tell my firm to be on top of this. Seriously.
Conflict of interest.
I don't do that kind of work.
Yeah. But no, I think it, And this is the thing, like, you and I go to enough minor league games and we've talked about it, that like the current model, like, well, there's just, there's a lot of issues with it. Like, yep. There's, we go to games and like, I'll know, like, I'll deliberately avoid going to the first home game after a road trip because teams often aren't up right. to their like stand.
They're tired.
Like, they're not, they're tired. They're frankly, people get tired. Shocking.
Think about how you felt today.
Yeah.
Think about how you felt on Monday at work. Were you productive?
Yeah.
Maybe like, you were productive because it was the start of the week and you're a go-getter. How are you on Friday?
Yeah. But like, imagine having to, you know, go straight to the office after arriving at 4 a.m. after an 8-hour bus ride or whatever. Like,
when you have a red-eye flight, do you go into work the same time the next morning? If you do, you're a warrior, but you know that you're a unicorn.
But like, there's like certain things like that. Or like, I'll go to a game and like, we do it even with Red Sox affiliates. You know, there's only a handful of guys on each team that you're actively paying attention to. Like, you're watching everyone, but people only really care about a handful of guys, or there's only a handful of guys with major league potential. And it's not just the Red Sox. This is all affiliates.
Think about the number of players the Red Sox sign out of indie ball to fill the Salem or Portland rosters in a given year because they need a guy to play the outfield.
Yeah.
Well, how does that, I mean,
yeah,
that's silly.
Yeah.
That's silly.
And like, but you also have, yeah, and that just shows, like, there's probably too many teams if that's what teams are having to do.
Yeah.
Like, you know, there's no need. There's no – teams shouldn't be having to go out there and, like, struggle to fill rosters, like, find guys like that. Like, I don't know.
Let me put it this way for people listening, and one kind of final thought. If you're still not on the wavelength with us, if you're not willing to – I think you have to think outside the box to get this. Think about before you understood minor league baseball. Think about what you thought when you first learned that the minor league clubs didn't pay the players. It was a little weird, right? Why does it have to be that way, right? Why do we assume that MLB just has to provide these teams with players? Why do we presume that it needs to be this many levels? Why does it need to be five levels? Why does it need to be six levels? Why can't it be four and the complex? Why is that not okay? You know, I think, you know, like we said, I think you get I think everything adjusts based on the talent in the league. I think it makes a lot of sense. I think the timeline doesn't make sense, but I think everything else about
I think
makes
parts
sense.
Of it make a lot of sense. There are other parts that don't make sense, and the timeline is very problematic. But like, I as a general point, just people who are hesitant to change, like, I'm going to go back to like the experience I have from, I'm a Big Ten guy. People know, went to Michigan. Big Ten's not the Big Ten anymore.
No.
There's more than 10 teams in it. And when that first started, there were traditionalists were up in arms. You know what I mean? Well, Maryland, Rutgers,
still,
they're not
it's
Big
still
Ten
weird.
Football.
It's still weird.
It's still weird today. But you know what? It's the same football. Granted, there's a team that has no business being in the league because they're atrocious, and Rutgers that loses every year to Michigan by like 70 points. Mm-hmm. And then you have Maryland, who's not very good either. But it's the same football. Like, and just because it's not what I grew up with doesn't make it, you know, that radically different, or doesn't mean it's the wrong decision for the league. Because at the end of the day, these things are all – they're all money-making entities.
Right.
So at the end of the day, as everything is about the bottom line, like, just because it's not what we're used to, like, who says that what we're used to is the right way? Like, you know, what you described, for example, like, the Red Sox have gone through multiple affiliates in our time doing this, you know, and it hasn't really changed that much for us. Like, it's just made some of it's been easier now to get to games or whatever. But like, if them in Lancaster, them in Salem, that doesn't change it that much for us. Like, it's change is going to happen. Change has been happening. This is just a more radical change happening at once. And if it was spread out over the course of years with, you know, dropping one team here, one team there, people would hardly notice. It's just because it's going to be one sweeping change.
Let's put it that way. Let me point that out. For those listening, you do all recall that like before last season, before 2018, two teams moved from the California League to the Carolina League, right?
Yeah.
Oh, you didn't know that?
Yeah.
That's Ian's point.
Yeah. Like if it was a slow drip process, people don't notice these things. But when it's, you know, one giant leak or one giant, you know, spout going down, that's when things get noticed. And that's the situation we're in because Major League Baseball and Minor League Baseball have significant disagreements over what should happen. And we're running to the end of the contract. So it's forcing people's timelines.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think that's kind of like the best way to sum it up is like, if it was a slow drip, just wouldn't care. But now it's like, we're looking at it, and both sides have their merits. It's going to be very interesting to see what happens. Obviously, it's going to impact us in some capacity. We don't know how much.
Right.
But, right. And I'm very interested to see that. But like,
do we still need to rank 60 if they get rid of like 40 players?
You might actually have to, because there'd be more like noteworthy players. You know what I mean? It would be like,
I don't know.
I don't know.
All right. I mean, so anyway, we'll keep an eye on this. We'll report back here with any news. The two sides took October off because of the baseball playoffs, and they're supposed to come back to the table in November. MLB is apparently bringing a very different team of negotiators that's going to be more representative of the different cuts of ownership, as opposed to just – I guess they only brought their labor group to the initial negotiations on this. So we'll have to wait and see.
And well, it's going to be interesting too,
because
as someone – I think it's in the Baseball America article, they pointed out that the winter meetings – they bring all like the major league teams and the minor league teams are all there represented. Like, that could get a little awkward. It
could get extremely awkward.
The
winter meetings are the minor league baseball expo.
Yeah.
And the major league teams just show up to do business.
Yeah.
So are they not going to be welcome? Like, it's going to be interesting,
but yeah.
All right. Anyway. Well, anyway, that's us spouting off about that. If you've got questions, you know, to follow up, maybe we can gather up some questions people have about this. You know, points you have, even if you have a point to make, I'd be interested in hearing what people have to say about this, Ian. podcast@soxprospects.com. We want to hear, but we want to talk about what you want to hear about. We also want to hear what you think about what we're talking about. If you have thoughts on this, we'd love to hear them, and we'll read them on the show and provide some thoughts of our own in return. You know, we've got a lot of listeners who tell us really interesting stuff by email, on Twitter. So don't be afraid to reach out with your thoughts. Ian, let's wrap it up. How is Team USA doing? Do we know? We got to check on the Premier 12 team. They're up 9-7 now.
Yeah, the pitching kind of let them down a little bit.
Penn Murphy gave up 4 runs. So Dahlbeck is still 1-for-3 with the RBI single. He's got a walk as well. Mm-hmm. Whether he's got a run scored. So no Chatham yet, no Song. But Team USA getting a run for their money. Neftali Feliz now in for the Dominican Republic.
Ooh, that's a throwback.
Yeah.
Wasn't he on the Red Sox at some point?
I think he was in Triple. He was in Pawtucket, yeah. As was Carlos Piguero, who's
DH-ing. I do remember that.
So, this is my favorite game to play with the winter leagues and with international.
Clayton Richard, who was pitching, was at one point the quarterback for the Michigan Wolverines.
All right.
Fun fact.
Interesting.
Yeah.
You know who else used to be the quarterback for the Michigan Wolverines?
Yeah. Some Brady guy.
Dan Greer. I was gonna say him. And then I was gonna say Brian Greasy, and I said Dan. It's time. I'm tired. I gotta go to bed. It's
10:30.
All right. Thank you all for listening. Thanks so much to Podcast Joe, our producer, editor extraordinaire, who does a great job. It's thankless work, but we're thankful for Joe. Thanks, man. Follow us on Twitter. I don't think I did this last time. Follow Ian at Ian Kundal. That's IanCundall. You can follow me at SP Chris Hatfield, HatField, not HAD like the astronaut, or HET like the frontman for Metallica. Make sure you check out the news page, news.soxprospects.com. We've got the monthly notes all off season. We've got the weekly fall winter league recaps. So those are pretty boring right now. Thank God. The Puerto Rican League is starting up in a couple weeks. Maybe next episode we'll preview that, because there's
the Dominican Winter League started, but I don't think they have anyone playing, right?
There's no one who isn't a projected, at least, minor league free agent from the Red Sox playing in either Mexico or
the Dominican.
I mean, Mexico, you've got Teddy Stankiewicz and Connor Wade pitching. And in the Dominican, you've got John Nunez, Domingo Tapia, Henry Mejia, and...
And Anilo Gomez.
Anilo Gomez, thank you.
Yeah.
And there's one more pitcher. So all of those guys are minor league free agents who became minor league free agents today, actually, we should mention. If you head to SoxProspects.com and up in the top on the banner, there's a link called Lists. You can get to the minor league free agent list there, so you can check that out. For Ian, I'm Chris. Thank you, everybody, for listening. Thank you, Joe. We're out. We'll be back soon with another episode. Just like stones in an ocean.